1 year ago, I had analyzed a video by Mark of Missing the Mark, where he complained about this idea of lack of belief atheists and how what they do is dishonest and it's a shifting of the burden of the proof. And in this video, he tried to explain how this is just wrong and incoherent and it doesn't make sense. And I pointed out the various logical fallacies of the video. And then I challenged him to a debate. That didn't go too well. He declined my invitation and made fun of the various debate topics that I had. But he said one day I would face my wrath. One day he and his friend would get together and analyze my rebuttal video, respond to it, and pwn the ever-loving pwnage out of me. Well, it's been a year, and finally, Mark has served me notice. His video is at last up. I've never been so excited for a rebuttal video. I've waited so long for this, and I'm sure that Mark's going to have lots of logic for me to consider. Rational response to my original video. He's going to point out the empirical evidence that I've overlooked all this time. Show me the archaeology that proves that the Bible history is correct. Completely, utterly annihilate me with facts, data, different tests that are repeatable, observable, and understandable that make predictions and can actually conclude something. I'm sure that he is going to pick apart my argumentation and show how logically fallacious it is. Oh, man. By the time it's over, I think that I'm not going to be able to sit down anymore, because my rear end is going to be completely and utterly spanked by him. I think that by the time that this analysis of my video is over, I'll have to admit that there is a God, and it's Mark's version of God. I'll have to kowtow to him and apologize publicly for ever questioning his ability to use logic or reason. Well, I'm not afraid to be wrong. So, watch with me Mark's response video.
You've made. And so a friend of mine and I have been talking about response videos, and we're both fans of Mystery Science Theater 3000. And so I had invited him to come over. He's going to come over in a few months originally, and to do the response with me, kind of the idea being at the time Mystery Science Theater 3000 style, because I'd seen a little bit of it and seemed appropriate to me. Anyway, things didn't work out. He wasn't able to come at that time. So finally, just recently, he visited me. But in the interim, there was Deconverted Man's debate challenge, which I made fun of, and then his response to it. And well, and finally, anyway, long story short, my friend got cold feet, and he didn't want to do it with me after all, and I'll let him explain.
As I believe Christopher's already indicated in his introduction to this video, he's been meaning to do this for quite a while, and the original intention was to have a friend join him in the video. That friend is me. That friend is also opting out, and should probably provide a bit of an explanation why. right after Christopher started his YouTube channel, we sort of speculated about what his first video response to his channel would be like.
What the hell am I looking at?
Well, forget exactly which was the very first, but there was a fellow by the name of Deconverted Man who came along. When Deconverted Man first published his video, watched a couple of moments of it, got distracted, meant to go back to it, never did.
Pass this part. In fact, never play this again.
And then Christopher posted a video responding to Deconverted Man's today challenge. Here's my questions. You can only start. So I actually watched the video that I responded to Christopher. And then I watched the video that Deconverted Man gave response to Christopher's video about today challenge. He's always sincere. The argument, you know, the man, the message, not sincere. But when it came to Deconverted Man's original video,
this is Deconverted Man's friend, and I don't want to do this video either, because having both of us in the same room at the same time would be hard. We're different people, though, totally. Just trust me on this. Yeah.
Oh my god! What's wrong with your face? What's wrong with your face? What's wrong with your face?
Because a great deal of his video was basically premised on misunderstanding what my video was. He evidently took it to be a video attempting to convince atheists that they should not be atheists. It was nothing of the kind. It was, as I thought was fairly clear, a video talking about a phenomenon that goes on and why it is dishonest. That is, this thing that atheists do and why it is not honest that they do that. I'm looking at a phenomenon. I'm not trying to convince anybody of anything. Today we're going to revisit the definition of atheism as a lack of belief in God, specifically to look at why it's so controversial. As you may recall, Anthony Flew first proposed changing the definition of atheism to lack of belief from its traditional definition of one who denies God in his 1976 essay, The Presumption of Atheism. You can see the traditional definition in the word's etymology, atheosism, atheos meaning without God and the ism suffix denoting a belief system. Now, there's nothing inherently wrong in changing a definition. All definitions are just an agreement that a given symbol, in this case a word, should be used to point to a particular referent. That is, any word can mean anything we all agree it does. I'm looking at a phenomenon, I'm not trying to convince anybody of anything.
Here, book, or whatever where they're defining the term. Words cannot be defined correctly or incorrectly, but they can be defined usefully or uselessly. And more to the point here, they can be defined in good faith, clearly, to aid mutual understanding, or in bad faith, cleverly, in order to disguise a rhetorical trick.
I'm looking at a phenomenon, I'm not trying to convince anybody of anything.
Oh, I see. So you made a video that's not about trying to convince anybody that the phenomenon in question is actually true. You're just talking about it. But you're not trying to convince anybody that the stuff that you're talking about is actually correct or true. My bad, you're just making a video to make a video, where you're just talking about things to talk about them. You're not trying to prove any point, or make an argument, or show any proof of anything that you say. It's not like you looked at the definition of atheist and then completely got it wrong in the very next sentence or something. Play the video again.
You can see the traditional definition in the word's etymology. Atheosism. Atheos meaning without God, and the ism suffix denoting a belief system. No.
Without a belief system. In other words, lacking belief, lacking faith in God specifically. Why is this so hard for Mark? Why? Oh, but the video is not about disproving atheism or proving theism. I don't care what your video is about. The intention of your video doesn't change the fact that you had logical fallacies in your video that I pointed out and I took you to task for. The fact of the matter is you go off on tangents about somebody changing the definition of atheism in some essay that I could care less about. I could care less. I care a little bit about it. To then saying, well, atheists really have the burden of proof, and that's why they say they lack a belief, because then they don't have to shoulder the burden of proof, and it's a really dishonest tactic, and that's why they do this. It's not controversial that atheists say we don't believe in God or that we lack a belief in God. That idea, that concept isn't controversial. So, what's his issue? Well, rocks can be atheists because they lack a belief in God. No, they don't have a way to believe or not believe because they're inanimate objects. So they can't lack a belief in anything. In fact, they don't believe in anything. So applying that label where it doesn't belong is incoherent. But it doesn't matter because what was it you said again, Mark?
I'm looking at a phenomenon. I'm not trying to convince anybody of anything. It would make as much sense to take I could make a criticism as off the point by taking Deconverted Man's video to be a lawnmower repair tutorial, and then noting, man, this isn't even about lawnmowers. You never mention lawnmowers. This is the world's worst lawnmower repair video. His video was largely about that relevant to my video, as taking his that way would be. There's also, there's a second thing, and this is kind of a minor point just about his video in itself, but a lot of what he said was premised on the idea that he has never seen any evidence for God or any logical arguments for God. The test thing's a little bit silly for reasons I'll get into in a minute. Now, he doesn't, however, offer any evidence for this. And there are two reasons why he should. Rather than just expecting us to take his word on it, the first being that all of the universe, everything we interact with, is evidence for its creator.
And so he did weep, for logic had died that day.
All of the universe, everything we interact with, is evidence for its creator. All of the universe, everything we interact with, is evidence for its creator. All of the universe, everything we interact with, is evidence for its creator. All of the universe, everything we interact with, is evidence for its creator. All of the universe, everything we interact with, is evidence for its creator. All of the universe, everything we interact with, is evidence for its creator.
Yeah, pain and suffering, who cares? It's all free will anyways, and humanity screwed up and God had to punish them with all these terrible things. And so when a volcano comes or an earthquake comes or a hurricane comes and destroys you, your loved ones, animals, property, whatever, that's all because of sin. And that's not really God's fault. Okay, yeah, he made the whole system in the first place knowing that it would happen, but it's not really God's fault, right? But all these negative things, they're not evidence against God, they're all evidence for God, right? It's for a weird creator that's rather evil, as well as benign, sometimes. Because sometimes God does good things, and sometimes God does bad things. Well, God allows bad to happen, and permits good to flourish, and backpedal, apologetics. But you asked me to point to evidence of there not being a God. And I was going to take my camera and show my room and be like, look, there's no God here. And I was going to go outside and look around and be like, hey, no God out here either. But then you said this stupid, inane, logically fallacious statement that everything is evidence of God. So no matter what I pointed to, it wouldn't matter. So I literally cannot show you what you want me to show you because you already made up your mind about it. Wow. That is just apologetics 101. That is pure, unadulterated faith. Your idea can't be falsified. You can never be shown to be wrong because there's no piece of evidence that I could bring forward to suggest that there isn't a God. So your complaint and your criticisms are moot.
So the world is literally nothing but evidence for God. There is nothing anywhere which is not evidence for God. Now, of course, evidence, as I mentioned in my video on evidence, needs to be interpreted properly.
Yes, and if you interpret everything this other magical way, then you'll see that we all came from the lobster original deity which pinched the universe into existence way back when, don't you know? If you just look at it the right way, my way, then you'll understand. Here's an idea. Let's discard missing the mark's way of interpretation of evidence and use something that's been shown to be reliable, produce results over and over again. It's this little thing I like to call the method of, what was it again? Science, right? Oh, well, I know, but science can't test God because God is not natural. Apologetics, philosophy, blah, blah, blah. I don't care about that stuff for now. Let's put that to the side and let's just get to a thing that actually can get us to a conclusion that people can agree on in large numbers, that can undergo critical analysis and multiple scrutinies and can be falsified. Let's just look at something like that rather than saying, well, if you just interpret the evidence, right? Ha 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 ha. And I know how to do that. I'm a person on the internet. Look, I'm a person on the internet too. And there is no my way of interpreting the evidence. There's only what the evidence is. Then you have some data, some tests run on it, some logically coherent arguments about it, and that leads you to some sort of conclusion. But that's not good enough. Then you say, okay, everybody else, look at what I've done and criticize the bleep out of it and prove that it's wrong and blow it out of the water. And then they do that. They go to work doing that. And the parts that didn't work are gone. And I actually remove them, or they're removed for me. And what's left after all of that is what this thing really is. And if theology was anything like science, there wouldn't be a vast disagreement about what God is, how God works, how to obtain salvation, avoid damnation, what happens to you when you die, if you get reincarnated, if you have a soul or spirit or both, if there's a Trinity or not, if Jesus existed in bodily form or not, if you have to be baptized in this way or that, or if it matters, or if works is more important than faith, or if Allah's really the only God and you better believe it or we'll cut off your head, or if Hindus got it right or whatever. You wouldn't have that. You would have a convergence on a single idea about a single God.
So, I understand that atheists do not interpret it as evidence for God, but it is nonetheless evidence for God. I'm looking at a phenomenon. I'm not trying to convince anybody of anything. The second thing is that it is just wildly implausible that he has, according to him, spent time looking into this question and never come across any of the logically coherent, whatever precisely that's supposed to mean, arguments for God.
Pretty sure I said in the original video that I hadn't found a logically coherent argument yet. I've seen plenty of arguments, but none of them have succeeded at being logically coherent. And what do I mean by that? I mean valid and sound. Valid, sometimes. Sound, not once. Not yet. Every single argument for the existence of any type of God that I have read or heard so far has had one or more logical fallacy. And when I point this out to people, just like when I pointed out the numerous logical errors in your original video, rather than correct the errors, they double down or they pretend that the errors don't exist. And it doesn't matter what angle you approach it at or what words you use or don't use, the apologist slash theist will never admit that an argument for God is wrong. I've not seen it done. Maybe somebody out there will prove me wrong on that claim. I hope so. And be like, here, I found an argument for God and it sucks and it's logically incoherent. Maybe that will be Mark's next video to be like, hey, I wanted to do this just to prove deconverted man wrong. Here's an argument for God that's bad and why it's bad. But why would he do that? Because, I mean, he wants to argue for God. Why would he ever go to the time and trouble to find an argument against God that's bad? But I've spent time and energy looking for an argument that is valid and sound for God, and I have not found one. And as yet, nobody has presented one to me. I still wait for that logically coherent argument, but nobody's been able to deliver yet. You could have perhaps done that during our debate, but you're unwilling and or unable to debate me for reasons. Because, ha ha ha, look at the silly debate topics. I would have pwned you on any one of them. Period. End of story. But the problem is you wouldn't understand that I had pwned you because I don't think you understand logic. But I could be wrong. Maybe you do. Maybe you're just really bad at doing logic. I don't know. But it doesn't really matter because the thing that you said before, what was that again?
I'm not trying to convince anybody of anything. Now, there are sound arguments for God, which is to say an argument which is both valid and its premises are true. I refer you to many of the arguments St. Thomas uses. There are a bunch of others as well.
Yeah, St. Thomas' arguments are full of logical fallacies. So, nope. And there's a bunch of other arguments as well. Wow, that was real impressive there. Love that list of arguments you gave. You know, I don't know. It's just for the tip of my tongue and or head. Let's see. Kalam cosmological argument. The argument from design. The argument for miracles. The empty tomb argument. The argument of morality. The unmoved mover argument. You know. There you go. There's a few. But they all have fallacies. So, no. They're not valid and sound. Valid, sometimes. Sound, no. But you can't admit that. And what's the point anyways? Because everything is proof of God to you. So you don't need an argument. Just go, look at this rock. There you go. I win. That's it. You don't need to do anything. Because, like you said, you're not trying to convince anybody of anything anyway, so I mean, you don't even need to give an argument, I guess.
I think I've seen a class something like there being about 12 really substantially distinct arguments for the existence of God, all of which are valid. I'm not sure whether or not that includes the so-called ontological proof from Saint Anselm, which generally, at least, I tend to ascribe to the position described by St. Thomas, that it's a valid argument for God, but the only one who could actually know that the premises are true is God himself. And so it seems a little bit pointless since God already knows that he exists. Anyway, be that as it may.
Blah, blah, blah. Skipping the part where he complains about other arguments that I should have run into, which every single argument that he brings up I've read and or heard, and none of them have the soundness that I'm looking for. They all have at least one or more logical fallacy and or sometimes formal fallacies, which don't count as much, but they're still problematic. But the informal fallacies, the logical fallacies, as we call them, those are what make me doubt the arguments. And rather than fixing them, theists just double down and say, no, those fallacies don't count. Interpret the evidence this way and look at it that way. And then you'll understand with your magical Bible glasses on how to see the world the right way so that you come to our conclusion. And that's just not good enough. It's not how logic functions.
The one other point I'd like to make is you brought up special pleading. And this is a thing which is often misunderstood by atheists, that special pleading, as I explained in my original video, special pleading is asking that two things which are properly in the same category be treated as if they are in different categories and have different rules applied to them. Special pleading is not saying that something is in a different category and then giving a reason why it is in a different category. That is not special pleading. That is properly understanding things according to what they are.
Oh, okay, so God belongs in its own special category, and that's not special pleading to put it in a special category. How does it belong in this special category again? And how do we know it's in that special category? Some sort of tautology, definitions, some sort of baseless assertions without any arguments or fallacious arguments that will not lead us to that conclusion? We can't empirically verify it, and we can't test it. So the only thing left is some arguments about it that are based on circular argumentations revolving around tautology of God is supernatural. You can't test or verify the supernatural. Science can't falsify or prove or do anything with the supernatural. So we'll never know about the supernatural other than by this special means of specially looking into it in this special way. Like, yeah, that's not special, Pleady. What was I thinking? That was sarcasm, by the way. Now, it is special, Pleady. For God to be in a different category, you'd have to show that God's in a different category. You'd have to actually, you know, show God, which is not possible because it's defined into such a position that demonstrating it is, well, impossible.
It gave a variety of things, but, like, you know, the trivial example being that a mathematical theorem can never be proved by scientific experimentation, and moreover, scientific theory is never going to be proved like a mathematical theorem. Each of those requires different sorts of proof, and the one simply doesn't work for the other, and the absence of one means nothing. The absence of a scientific experiment verifying a mathematical proof means precisely nothing.
You keep using the word. I don't think it means what you think it means.
God is clearly in a different category than creation, and to try to place them in the same category is the following sort of mistake.
Is it special pleading? No, it's not special pleading. You said that it's okay because it's in its own special category. So, please explain it without using an analogy.
Imagine two characters in a book who know that they're in a book and who are arguing about whether or not there's an author who is writing the book. And so the one character says to the other, okay, which words here are the author? I mean, everything else we interact with are words in this book, so clearly the author must be words in this book. Point me to which words in this book are the author, or there is no author.
But if these are characters in a book that know that they're in a book somehow, then they conceivably know what a book is, so why would they be arguing about an author at all? They would know that there's an author, and they would also conceivably know that you can't point to an author, and it's weird that they can point to the words. Like, are they themselves words? This analogy is starting to break down when you analyze it, almost like it's a appeal to analogy and not a very good one. But nevertheless, could the author just pen in a character that said, no, I'm the author, and see, I can do these things. I can erase myself halfway out of existence, and then I can write myself back in. And, you know, do it in the present tense of those characters' existence so that they can be sure about the author. Don't do it like, you know, several pages ago when they didn't exist. So, you know, but then they would know the end of the book, wouldn't they? Like, if they knew they were in a book. How does this work again? They know that they're in a... Wait, hold on. Nope, the analogy sucks.
Oh, you know, there are a bunch of other elementary mistakes. Most of them, either I've addressed just on the subject themselves, and I'll let those things stand, or it just wasn't about the video that I made. Like, just something that briefly comes to mind. If you've seen both videos, and I'll link them in the description, there's a part where I talk about this principle that atheists espouse but don't live, of how you should not believe in anything till somebody spoon feeds you proof that it is the case. And that if you actually took this principle seriously, normal life would break down. And deconverted man then went and gave an argument for why you shouldn't apply this principle. And in fact, you know, it was about clothing stores. And, you know, how you don't know that the clothing stores sell clothing that will fit you until you go there and find out. You don't sit back and wait for someone to prove it to you. You go investigate the world. And he gave an argument for why you should go and investigate the world and how it's reasonable to do so. His argument wasn't wrong, it was just irrelevant to what I was saying, because I was pointing out that a particular principle shouldn't be applied. He gave an argument for why not to apply it. In a sense, he was really agreeing with me, even though he seemed to be disagreeing with me. And so, like, the one comment I leave on that is, yeah, good job figuring out why you should go to clothing stores to buy clothing if you need clothing and have the money, etc.
Well, congratulations, Missing the Mark. You've successfully performed the largest cognitive dissonance that I've ever seen or heard. So, well done. By disagreeing with you, I somehow am agreeing with you. Wow. And your own argument, which was based on this faulty analogy, isn't really about that analogy, so why include it as part of your argument? Oh, but it wasn't part of the argument. What? Huh? And in the original video, where you talked about the clothing store and compared it to supposedly how atheists supposedly say that you should supposedly live, you said, well, it wouldn't make sense to do this. But my complaint was actually, it would make sense to do that, one. And secondly, we don't even need to do that in regards to clothing stores because we know that they sell clothing and we have good evidence that they do. So the analogy doesn't work and it still doesn't work. How many other ways can I say that it doesn't work? So me disagreeing with your analogy doesn't mean that I agree with you. I disagree with you. Your video is full of logical fallacies. Straw man, half-truths, asserting things without any proof. And in this video, it's nothing more than, well, you see, if you just interpret it my way, you'd understand. Everything is evidence of God. So in that case, I guess, just believe that everything is a clothing store without actually going to investigate it. Because you just know that there's clothing stores, but also the clothing stores are in their own special category where they're invisible and undetectable by any method at all. And you can't be sure that you're actually wearing clothing because they're invisible. And one little kid's like, you're naked. And you say, ah, only foolish people would say I'm naked. And yeah, so I guess the fool does say in his heart that there are no clothes. I mean, God, whatever the analogy is supposed to be about. It failed the first time. It fails again. Just let's wrap this up. I want to know, oh, well, you can't test God. I'm guessing he said he was going to address that. I'm guessing you can't test God because God's in its own little category, so you can't test it. So it's just silly. See, atheists, you don't understand. God's just in its own little magical category where there's no empirical evidence of it. There's no test for it. There's no sound argument for it. Maybe valid ones, but not any sound ones. But that's okay because everything's proof of God anyways. I'll play a little bit more and then I'll conclude this mess.
Part of diligence to the rest of life. Don't just stop. Actually go and investigate. Actually use your reason and apply it. Don't just sit back and say, I'm not going to apply my reason. I need to be spoon-fed. That really is the main objectionable thing to online atheists, is their arguments always amount to spoon-feed me.
Okay, so there's your piss-poor straw man once again. There's your potential ad hominem. Not an actual one, but a potential for one. Definitely poisoning of the well. Asking for evidence is not asking to be spoon-fed. Asking somebody to clarify their points is not asking to be spoon-fed. Asking why you think X is true is not asking to be spoon-fed. The burden continues to be on the person that makes the claim. That's how it works. Maybe if you have a problem with that, I could suggest not believing in things that have no evidence for them. Or if you're going to just believe something, just say, I believe it, and that's it. And say, well, atheists don't believe it, and that's it. You don't need to argue with anybody, because after all,
I'm looking at a phenomenon. I'm not trying to convince anybody of anything.
Mark did not give us empirical evidence, a repeatable test, and or a valid and sound argument for God, but that's okay, because that's not the point of his video anyway. See, God's in its own special category, so it doesn't need any of those things. And besides, everything is evidence of God. You just have to interpret the evidence the right, special, magical way. Yeah, so no, I'm not gonna do that, because for everything that we've known so far, there's been empirical evidence or a repeatable test for it, or at the very least, a valid and sound argument. And unless and until we have a logically coherent argument, which is what I call valid and sound arguments, we must continue to be skeptical of the conclusions. What? His name's not Mark? Why didn't you tell me before? Aw, man. Well, it's too late now. I'm not gonna fix it.